Hi friends, welcome to the NPTEL course Leadership for India Inc. Practical Concepts and Constructs. We are in week 6 discussing leadership structures. In this lecture, we will focus on stature versus title. In order to accomplish any task, achieve any goal, or carry out any activity in an organized manner, we require a group of people. Organizations are the primary vehicles to enable groups of people undertake certain tasks and achieve certain goals. We have discussed in the previous lecture several types of organizations. To recall, we could have a functional organization, a regional organization, a product organization, a service organization, a strategic business unit organization, or a global matrix organization. Each of the organizations typically has a chief executive officer at the helm and several CXOs, chief scientific officer, chief operating officer, chief marketing officer, chief financial officer, and so on. And each of these CXOs is supported by several functional heads. In a career spanning 40 to 50 years, an individual goes through several ranks, multiple grades, passes through multiple responsibility layers, and also has several titles. An organization is verily a canvas of roles and titles fitted into structures. Roles and responsibilities are typically expressed through titles. We have chosen this topic of title versus stature mainly because individuals tend to seek titles once they enter an organization. This is a phenomenon that is common at the entry level, at the middle management level, and even at the senior management level. As part of our course itself, we have talked about chief executive structures, CXO structures, and various other leadership positions as being very important for development of firms as well as for socioeconomic development. There could therefore be an institutionalization of thought in our minds that title is an extremely important aspect of a leadership journey. While titles are important, and they are important as long as they dutifully reflect the roles and responsibilities, I wish to focus your attention onto the important fact that stature is probably even more important. That's why this lecture focuses on the differences between title and stature and what we should seek as our primary objective once we are in an organization. Every organization is like a pyramid, narrow at the top and very broad at the bottom. It is therefore impossible for everyone who joins an organization to become the CEO. However, there are several avenues in which every individual, every employee, every executive can show his or her mettle and get a stature which is appropriate and commensurate with his or her capabilities. Another important thing to note is that irrespective of the scale of the company, the role of the CEO tends to be only one. I have presented here 6 companies from the Tata Group with employee strength ranging from 50 to 450,000. Turnover ranging from $14 million to $42 billion. All of these companies have only one chief executive officer. Even if they have little higher number of CXOs, the fact is that every company, regardless of this scale and size, would have only one chief executive officer. This underlines the challenge and the probably unnecessary requirement of trying to seek only the CEO role as the goalpost for career development or for leadership journey. There are 6 layers of hierarchy that can be looked at in organizations: executive, manager, general manager, vice president, president, and managing director. Over a period of time, the heads of human resources and the companies have recognized that the aspirations of individuals to move up the career ladder are very strong. Therefore, they have innovated to add several prefixes to each of these layers so that you can find at least 25 variants of the basic 6 layers of hierarchy. This provides an opportunity for individuals to move along the leadership journey with an increase in titles. And titles reflect social status apart from developing a perception of a role and responsibility. Titles are extremely important when individuals meet other individuals from other organizations. However, it is to be discussed and debated whether every movement across a title is being accompanied by a higher level of qualification, higher level of knowledge, higher level of true experience, and higher level of performance potential. That is something which we need to discuss, and some of these aspects will certainly be discussed as part of the leadership models that we would discuss later. Even a consulting organization, which is by and large intellectually driven, has several layers. It starts with analyst at the bottom and ends up with director title at the top. A typical consulting company, however, tends to have many partners at the helm, whereas the number of CXOs are very limited in a manufacturing organization or a product organization, and the CEO is only one. A typical consulting company tends to have many partners and a few directors, mainly because business generation, a consulting company, is related to the partners and directors the company has. When we look at noted consulting companies such as McKinsey and Company, BCG, Bain and Company, or Big Four companies such as PwC, KPMG, EY and Deloitte, you will find a similar structure and title situation. There are, of course, certain organizations which have flat organization structure. In the field of medicine, even if you are a noted surgeon, or if you are a noted physician, you tend to get referred as a senior consultant and chief consultant for decades. And a doctor or a surgeon won't mind that, because there is a stature associated with medical profession in terms of the ability to cure patients. And that is a halo which a doctor or a surgeon has and is independent of the title. Similarly, in the academic world, we do not have many titles: assistant professor, associate professor, professor, dean, director. These are probably the five important titles in an academic world. Academic world, in addition, is pretty non-hierarchical and individualistic. Laboratories are built around, or laboratories are associated with lead researchers. Courses, programs are related to individual professors. That's how the academic world stands. There are also certain domains where the title is almost a permanent prefix to an individual. In courts, justice is a standard prefix. In medicine, doctor is a standard prefix. In defense forces, people are referred to along with the rank as a prefix. And in education, as we have seen, professor is a prefix. In certain cases, like president of the nation, the title of the president stays on even when the president is off the tenure. Robin Sharma, the new age leadership guru and executive coach, came up with a best-selling book called The Leader Who Had No Title. Given the obsession of organizations as well as individuals with titles, I thought that the theme is quite apt for the times that we are in. I have therefore talked about the principles that come out of his book in the first part of this lecture. Robin Sharma proposes that for individuals to be leaders, mastery in their respective crafts is more important than titles. That is the essence of this book. We have to recognize that any organization will and must have titles. States, governments, religious entities have titles as much as corporate organizations, whether public or private sector organizations, have titles. That is a fact of life. But it is the mindless seeking of titles without concern for craftsmanship, or without concern for mastery, without concern for competence, that is the one which people should avoid. According to Robin Sharma, the whole idea behind leading without a title is the concept of democratizing leadership. Robin Sharma acknowledges that positions are important to the smooth running of any organization, whether the organization is a business organization, a community, or a family. Having said that, he proposes a new model of leadership, which is all about every single stakeholder showing leadership in the work he or she does. It is a model of distributed leadership, in that every single owner is a employee with the responsibility of showing leadership at his or her craft. That is, an employee behaves as an owner of the craft which he or she possesses and the responsibility he or she has to deliver. every single teammate is considered as the CEO of the business unit or the work unit, which is called normally as job. But Robin Sharma proposes that he should view the job as the responsibility akin to the CEO's responsibility for a company. You can feel that this is somewhat similar to the concept of grassroots leadership with reference to the medical representative that I discussed in an earlier lecture. It's only that Robin Sharma has given a deft posturing for that concept. That said, this concept is pretty difficult to implement in practice if this concept is to be taken to a logical conclusion in a program having hundreds of executives and organized by Robin Sharma himself. Robin Sharma cannot be the lead. He should be one amongst everybody, and everybody should be as full of leadership potential and coaching potential as Robin Sharma is. But that doesn't happen that way. All the people have assembled in such a program essentially to listen to Robin Sharma, get inspired by him. Therefore, leadership and title is somewhat intrinsic to the way the organizations have to be structured, run, and the way in which activities have to be performed and goals have to be delivered. The only question is that the mindless pursuit of titles is misleading and is non-appropriate. That is the whole point that is being made in this lecture. So Robin Sharma proposes a distinction between wanting to be a leader and demonstrating leadership. You may want to be a leader, but to be actually a leader, he proposes that one must demonstrate leadership. And the way to demonstrate leadership is to demonstrate mastery at whatever work you are doing. He also proposes self-leadership versus given leadership. Don't seek titles, but demonstrate the ability to lead by yourself so that leadership naturally comes to you. So ability to lead, regardless of the title, is fundamental to development of stature in an organization for an individual. Robin Sharma hasn't talked about stature, and the latter part of our lecture will talk about the concept of stature as developed by me. According to Sharma, leaders are those individuals who do the things that failures, that means failed leaders, are not willing to do. Too many people pay the sad costs of mediocrity and forego the spectacular rewards of being a leader. We are not talking about titled leaders. We are talking about leaders who are genuinely recognized for their leadership. Doing the same thing over and over again only inbreeds mediocrity in an organization and the individual. That's certainly not a path for leadership. Out-of-box thinking or out-of-box performance is essential for demonstrating leadership. In this book, there is a story told by Robin Sharma through the main character, Blake, who has conversation with four unorthodox leaders. Each of them works in a position that, based on conventional wisdom, would not be considered a leadership position. However, each conversation brings out key principles that can help ordinary people become true leaders. Principle number one, to lead without a title, one has to be persistent and courageous, because you are believing yourself and not on the positional power or the authority a title gives. Principle number two, challenging times are opportunities to learn and transform. Principle number three, the deeper the relationships, the stronger the leadership. It could be a dyadic relationship between a leader and the follower, or a larger member exchange leadership. That's extremely important. And the principle number four is that a great leader has to be fundamentally a great person. Robin Sharma proposes several principles, tools, and techniques to achieve this. And much of his leadership kit focuses on self-awareness and self-discipline. As people in India, we recognize that there is a strong oriental approach that emphasizes introspection as the foundation of self-development. And this also resonates very strongly with my current work on leadership as we move along and course through the leadership models that I have proposed in the forthcoming lectures. You will find that it is possible for us to become leaders and statured leaders, that too by having introspection, reflection, and self-development as the foundations of our leadership. If we really need to demonstrate to ourselves that stature is far more important than anything else in life, you can only look at Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. We call Gandhi Mahatma Gandhi because of his stature. Mahatma in Sanskrit denotes a person who is recognized and respected for his distinctive greatness. Mahatma Gandhi got us independence. He is regarded as the father of the nation. However, the stature did not come easy. It involved several distinctive capabilities and several distinctive ways of working, including the highest level of authenticity, the highest level of self-sacrifice, and the highest level of people orientation for Mahatma Gandhi to get the stature which he has got. And in his leadership, we can see several principles, several models of leadership that we all can follow. From a corporate organizational perspective, the concept of stature has certain very important considerations and implications. It can solve many issues of dynamics which are created by individuals hankering after title and by leaders trying to distribute titles as a way to please the followers. Let's try to define stature. We have defined stature a few times as we came along the course and even in this first part of the course. It is a status that comes to a person due to a combination of several attributes and contribution. According to me, leadership stature is not unidimensional. It is a function of knowledge, experience, performance, potential, wisdom, ethics, intuition, and several other leadership attributes, particularly the 30 leadership attributes we have discussed in an earlier class. It provides mutual reinforcement between individuals and institutions. We will cover this in one of the slides as we go along. It also inspires confidence and motivates acceptance of the statured individual by the followers. Stature is acknowledged universally, both inside and outside the organization, and gets identified with a crucial cause. Serves as the go-to leader for several constituents of an organization. Societies and natures doubtless have persons of stature, and organizations also have persons of stature. These gentlemen, these ladies are seen as common resources than dedicated to any particular institution or a particular department. They are beyond the definitions as we come across in organizations. Why does stature matter? Why should we consider stature as a concept which is far more important than title? The reason is in these 5 points. Stature matters at all levels in an organization, from a frontline executive to a chief executive. When an assembly line worker has a problem with the assembly line, whom does he go to? The formal organization structure says that he or she should go to the supervisor. However, the worker prefers to go to someone who has got the mastery at the assembly activity. That's where the stature starts kicking in, even at the very basic level in the organization. And this phenomenon continues all through the various levels of the organization. Secondly, institutions and individuals reinforce each other's status. Because of having statured individuals, institutions gain stature. And by being able to enter a statured institution, individuals also reinforce their capability. Quite apart from the fact that the processes, the learning mechanisms, the delivery mechanisms in such institutions and by such individuals are by themselves a notch higher than anything else which you can see in ordinary institutions and ordinary individuals. Thirdly, stature inspires confidence and motivates acceptance and or followership. That is, if you see a statured individual, you feel happy and confident that if you go and seek some advice from him or her, you will get the level of advice that make you yourself a master in that art or the activity. Fourthly, stature requires probity relative to anything else. That is, ethics, values, authenticity, they are part of stature. Fifthly, stature is built on positive performance and is always lost on negative performance. I must repeat that there is a strong element of honesty and ethics in stature, perhaps even more that of performance. I said earlier that statured individuals and institutions add luster to each other. You can see institutions adding luster to individuals, which is the reason why people try to join Ivy League institutions, whether it is in India or abroad. Indian Institute of Technology and Indian Institute of Management, as we know, are the corresponding Ivy League institutions in India. Similarly, big companies want to have individuals who are lustered with their stature, Sundar Pichai, Satya Nadella, Indra Nooyi, they have developed stature as part of their organizations, and that is the reason by which they could move up the hierarchy. And their being associated with such organizations as Alphabet, Microsoft and PepsiCo added more stature to them. So it is symbolic of the mutual stature building that several top honchos getting early traction due to the institutional stature and institutions gaining from the leadership achievements of the distinguished alumni. That is a virtuous cycle that happens. I must also say that stature remains beyond title. Ratan Tata may have ceased to be the chairman, that is the full-time chairman of Tata Group. Nevertheless, the stature has not deserted him. In fact, the stature is only increasing. So is it with N.R. Narayan Murthy. He is just a founder of Infosys after being chairman of Infosys for decades and having contributed to its growth. But still, he is looked upon as the leader in corporate governance and in information technology. K.V. Kamath, the ace and versatile banker, has a stature, whether he is part of the BRICS Bank, was a part of the ICICI Bank, or an independent thinker at this point of time. V. Krishnamurthy, former chairman of SAIL, PHEL and Maruti Suzuki, still commands enormous stature for his manufacturing wisdom. Azim Premji, Nandan Nilekani, CNR Rao, Professor CNR Rao actually, Dr. Y.V. Reddy, Dr. C. Rangarajan, Dr. R.A. Mashelkar, Dr. Maruti Subramaniam, Jaggi Vasudev, they have stature. And it is not related to their being in the office or out of the office, their being doing an advisory role or they're doing a full-time role. Many companies try to retain this connect by bestowing chairman's emeritus or professor emeritus title to such persons of stature. But needless to add, they add stature to the titles that are given to them even after their tenures. What is the conundrum between stature and title? From a logical perspective, statures and titles in an organization would need to be positively correlated. You have got higher stature, you should have a higher title. And if you are a person of higher title, you should display that level of stature. However, it is not necessary that all people with titles have a corresponding stature. It is also not possible to see very clearly and universally that all peoples of stature have been provided with great titles. So why does this dichotomy or dissonance happen? That is the stature title conundrum. One of the reasons why this happens is as follows. Not all persons of stature tend to be title seekers or position seekers. We can have several illuminated and illuminating leaders. Mahatma Gandhi, Swami Vivekananda, Martin Luther King, Mother Teresa, for example, they have not sought any title. So Congress party may have had several leaders with titles, but Mahatma Gandhi never sought any title. Other reason, in certain cases, positions may require actions that are not in line with this stature. Hence, people of stature eschew titles. That is, you are known for such authentic leadership, such intellectual wisdom, that it is somewhat inappropriate for being in a title which has certain mundane activities to be carried out by the person. And in certain other cases, the higher titles may not match the preferences of the statured individual. An absolutely brilliant academician, even if he is given a title of the dean or the director, the correlation between absolute academic brilliance and the reflection that comes from the title may not correlate with each other. That is another part of the conundrum. In national governance, for example, one may need to act independent of a recognized stature to remain or manage affairs at the helm. In academics, as I said, the most accomplished or the most statured professor may not accept the position of the director of an institution due to a diffidence towards non-academic administrative work. The conundrum of stature, title, match or mismatch arises basically from these four factors. When conundrum is not resolved in an appropriate manner and when organizational ecosystems fail to recognize the true stature and reward it in terms of separating individual brilliance or lack of it from institutional brilliance or lack of it, then there would be a problem. If titles are bestowed which are not commensurate with stature, and people with stature are not recognized with appropriate titles, the conundrum could lead to conflict. The conflict arises if ecosystems confuse stature and title, expertise and title, without understanding the deep imports. The conundrum becomes self-limiting constraint when the ecosystems themselves do not have a good culture and good scale and good scope that can accommodate individuals of great stature. The conundrum also becomes intellectual riddle when ecosystems consider that stature implies statesmanship and wisdom, while title requires a go-getting and risk-taking performance. It is a riddle. And when properly understood, stature becomes an artifact, a very important and helpful artifact developed by the person to inspire the society long after the titles are forgotten. So we need to resolve this conundrum from becoming a conflict into one which would be a very helpful inspiration for the organization as well as for the people at large. We have to have a situation where stature is recognized far more than the title. Even if there are more titled individuals than statured individuals, we should be able to recognize stature as a supreme force in an organization. If you do not do that, it will become unmanageable. If you start viewing leadership as being all about getting results only and all about dispensing titles, then it would not be good. On the other hand, it would be resolved when leadership is viewed as being all about building the stature for the individual as well as for the institution, more than just about achieving results. We can have examples of where stature and title are very well aligned. You have Art of Living Foundation. The founder, Pandit Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, holds the highest stature in the institution, and he is also at the helm. So he is the head of Isha Foundation, Sadhguru Jagdev. He holds the highest stature in the institution, and he also holds the highest position in the organization. Ideally, every organization, if it needs to be a virtuous organization, must align and integrate stature and title. However, this seems to be done easier in organizations dedicated to philosophy, spirituality, religion, or theology, rather than organizations which are pursuing product strategies, revenues, transactional strategies, and so on. And the basis for that is the stature title conundrum, which we have discussed, and the way in which stature can be built as an artifact of the individual and the institution needs to be pursued by organization. Whenever you give significant importance to the intellectual power, the ability to be wise and guide people, nurture people, stature comes into prominence automatically. The two examples I have given in this lecture are because the intellectual power of these individuals is at the highest level and is also making stature and title in tandem. There is also a duality of stature and title. In certain governmental structures, which are superior organizations of nations, there is a possibility to attempt simultaneous separation of democratic stature and title from intellectual stature and title of sovereign representation stature admirably. You have an example of Prime Minister, who was an illustrious Indian politician, statesman and poet, Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji. He served two partial terms and one full term as the Prime Minister of India. And Prime Minister of India, as we know, is the leader of the executive of the Government of India. We also have APJ Abdul Kalam, who was an illustrious Indian aerospace scientist and politician who served as the President of India. Moreover, he was the greatest educationist after Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, who graced that high office. The President of India is the ceremonial head of the State of India and Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces. The separation of the apolitical presidential position and a political, democratically elected prime ministerial position in national governance is a great example. The way the roles are envisaged under the Constitution of India and the democratic electoral process of India, both positions required persons of eminence and stature, reflecting how separations of role and title can still be aligned under a constitutional process, under a well-thought-out process. We should hand it to the framers of the Indian Constitution for having done this. Stature and title in governance. The corporate structures represent another approach of separating two important roles with a clear idea of ensuring appropriate corporate governance process. Rono Dutta is the CEO of Indigo. He is the managing director and CEO. It is a full-time responsibility for strategic and operational matters of a company. But the person is accountable to the board of directors headed by the chairperson. And for the same company, we have M. Damodaran, who is the reputed Indian corporate advisor, mentor, and the chairman of illustrious bodies such as SEBI, UTI issue he could resolve. He was also a chairman of IDFC Bank at some point of time. And he was a very reputed former senior government official. He is the chairman. So you have seen the split of the title in terms of two distinct responsibilities and actually two different titles to reflect the separation of two aspects of corporate governance. So the separation of a vice chairman position from a smart CEO position in corporate leadership, or constitution of a board of directors made up of persons of stature for corporate governance, are some examples of alternatives to align and integrate stature and title in commercial organizations. How do we lead with stature? It may be possible to lead without title, but it would be impossible to lead without stature. This is because leadership is not only about competencies to lead people and businesses for smart performance, but also about stature to assure them for wise and good governance. We have to assure our team members that you are with a statured leader who is looking not just for results, who is looking for the sustainability of the organization, sustainability of the strategies, sustainability of people development. So it is necessary for individuals to acquire stature in their domains of work from the very early stage of their careers and build on their stature progressively and consistently. Performance may be measured by metrics and communicated, but stature is reflected by performance with wisdom and easily experienced by various constituents of the organization. Certain firms, conglomerates, and leaders have superior statures compared to others, independent of their scale and scope, which only validates this hypothesis that stature is much more tangible, recognizable, and much more lasting than performance. True leadership accomplishment, therefore, captures the imagination and trust of a broad sweep of population, be it of organizations or societies. It establishes the true stature of an individual or an organization. Despite all the challenges discussed herein, organizations in their quest for virtuosity must seek to align and integrate titles with statures. Then the organizations become extremely authentic and extremely role modeling entities. It stands therefore to logic that companies must go the extra mile to ensure that all the persons of eminence in an organization get titles that reflect their capabilities and potential to help the organization. But why doesn't it happen that way always? Because leaders tend to centralize their power. They are unwilling to consider multiple views. They have their intrinsic inability to respect non-direct contribution. Inadequacies in understanding stature. When leaders have these deficiencies, even if the organizations are fortunate to have people of stature, their wise counsel, their sage counsel, their sagacity, and their ability to guide the leaders is unfortunately not tapped enough. The institutional knowledge, intellectual power, and experiential wisdom that persons of stature bring to the organization must be protected, must be preserved, must be nurtured, and must be leveraged. There are certain options to be able to do that. How do we do that? Let's say we have R&D. We can have a chief scientific officer who is in charge of regular activities. There could also be a chief innovation officer. The chief innovation officer is the one who has that greater interest in stature, innovation stature, and who is willing to forego a title. So such a person who is not interested in these races for chief executive position and things like that should still be recognized and respected and his stature recognized through an appropriate title. And that's how you can have a chief scientific officer and a chief innovation officer coexisting in an R&D setup. In strategy, you require a chief strategy officer. But you could also have a chief business officer who directs this whole business of the company from an independent and a macro perspective for long-lasting performance. So you accommodate stature as well as title in this kind of situation. We can have a company with the chief executive officer like every other company has, but you can also have the position of chief mentor, wherein the statured individual could be placed and the abilities which he brings to the position would be helpful not only to the CXOs but to the chief executive officer and the board of directors as well. In any domain, we can think of the formal title of hierarchy being as it is, but a subject matter expert being position based on the stature he possesses, the mastery he possesses, the craftsmanship he possesses in his particular area of work or even in several areas of work. This kind of construct of duality of leadership positions, one based on the title and one based on the stature, ensures that leaders and experts of eminence are retained in the organizational system. It provides the wisdom to operating leaders and functionaries. This is facilitated in part because the drivers of self-actualization are different for operating leaders, that is leaders who seek the formal titles of hierarchy and are happy with those titles, and for subject matter experts or the statured leaders who do not wish the formal titles of hierarchy but are required to be retained in the organization, appropriately positioned to serve as role models. So the drivers of self-actualization, as I said, vary substantially between leaders predominantly seeking titles and those predominantly satisfied with stages. Let's say the factory's knowledge. Title seekers do enough to deliver on performance, whereas stature builders have a continuous quest for knowledge. On the dimension of experience, title seekers try to provide more results in a unit time, whereas stature builders are cognizant of the impact the business requires. On intuition and instinct, title seekers are more instinctive than intuitive, and stature builders are more intuitive than instinctive. On the recognition dimension, title seekers look for corporate growth, whereas stature builders look for corporate reputation. In terms of relationships, performance-driving relationships are facilitated, encouraged, and sought after by title seekers, whereas stature builders look for knowledge-exchanging relationships. In terms of decisiveness, title seekers are fast and smart, whereas stature builders have the intrinsic ability to be fast and smart, but more importantly, they are also wise. The above construct of having different characteristics of leadership personality ensures that leaders and experts of eminence are retained in the organizational system, providing their wisdom to operating leaders and functionaries. So we have to keep in mind that the drivers of self-actualization are different for operating leaders and statured leaders, and accordingly benefit from these traits and capabilities and delivery goals that these two types of leaders have. The ideal combination, title with stature, greatness for the company. You have title without stature, you have inadequacy for the company. You have stature, but you don't have title adequacy for the company. So it is for the leaders of the organization, the boards, the directors, the investors to decide what kind of balance or integration between title and stature they should try for. Clearly, we should have title along with stature institutionalized in the company for the greatness. Organizations must guard against proliferation of title without a modicum of stature. That is going to take the company down the hill. We should always look for title along with stature to ensure the greatness of the company. This is true of industrial organizations as much as for academic institutions, governments, or any other type of organization. As I said, there are many examples of leaders with title and stature. You have got T.V. Mohandas Pai, who was a shining title holder in Infosys. He was out of Infosys for long, but still continues to have the stature. And as a result of that, he continues to have a great title as well. We have Satish Khanna, who worked as the president of the API business of Lupin and was responsible for turning around and growing that business. He became an angel investor and adventurer, explorer of the world from Arctic and Antarctic, sharing his knowledge and perspectives with several hundreds of followers. Meg Whitman, upon leaving HP, she became a political activist and philanthropist. A.G. Lafley, he left P&G as CEO in 2010, but when P&G was faced with adversity, he came back to head P&G again, and he did that with aplomb. Stature is a unique asset of leaders that needs to be tapped by organizations. Stature will also blossom into a cross-industry phenomenon, in which case leaders become resources for the industry and the economy. How does that happen? Any person of eminence could be a member of board of directors or member of advisory board for a company. These boards are ideal places for statured individuals to join and contribute their knowledge and experience. If you are a member of the board of directors, you could be non-executive independent director and look for performance enhancement and governance for the company with legal responsibility and accountability. When these two things happen together, you are definitely contributing to the growth of the organization. Need not necessarily be with day-to-day responsibilities, which could distract you from fulfilling this very important governance activity. You could also be a member of advisory board as a strategic advisor or operational advisor and look at this performance enhancement for the company with the option of adding also the governance aspects of the company, but without legal responsibility and accountability. These are the two ways in which persons of stature can contribute to organizations and entity. As a statured individual, one can be on several boards. As per the current law, I believe it is 20. But there are various other options, not even as a member of advisory board. There could be several other options by which persons of eminence can contribute. The person can be a consultant, an academician, a startup founder, a startup investor, an author, a social service individual. A person of eminence can contribute in any of these six positions besides being a member of board of directors or advisory board. So there is an eclectic mix of positions that are available for statured individuals to contribute to the firms, to the industry, economy, and society. So people of stature should not move into the cocoons. They should keep contributing to the broader world. Similarly, organizations must not view the persons of stature only in terms of their age or their formal positions. They should be considered as wise, sagacious people who have seen all of professional and personal life and have accumulated so much experience with wisdom that organizations would continue to be benefited as long as they are in a position to provide those levels of inputs. To be able to do all that, we need continued self-actualization even for the seasoned leaders. I want to demonstrate two types of individuals who demonstrated exceptional capabilities. One focused on visionary leadership. The leader built an institution and industry for India and acquired legendary stature. Stature is not something that is necessarily associated with organizations and corporations. Individuals of outstanding accomplishments acquire a stature that is immense and that stands out as a legacy. F.C. Kohli, he is considered the builder of Tata Consultancy Services, TCS, the most valuable corporate jewel in the Tata conglomerate crown. He is also considered the father of the Indian IT industry. Even at 96 years, he possessed such stature that he is considered the doyen of the IT industry, and people wanted to be benefiting from his experience and expertise. In 2018, that is at his ripe age of 94 years, he was bestowed a great honor by the government of Tamil Nadu for his contributions to the IT industry. He was working initially in the electrical engineering and power industry after his master's from MIT. At that point itself, he visualized the importance of electronics and computing in the 1950s. After undertaking several senior level assignments in the Tata Group, after certain assignments in the overseas companies, he set up TCS in 1969 as per the association with JRT Tata and developed the company as a leader in the global software industry. Kohli headed several industry associations related to electrical engineering and software. Extremely knowledgeable and adroitly action-oriented, he was also extremely humble and simple. His sage counsel was always sought after by the Tata Group companies, especially the boards which are of companies that are technology driven. If you look at F.C. Kohli's life, he was a pioneering visionary who showed the way to build an entire industry for India. He built the Indian IT industry into global leadership through the pathways he demonstrated through TCS. Recognizing his human contributions, the government of India recognized him with Padma Bhushan, India's third highest civilian honor. He also received several other awards as well. Apart from his corporate and industry leadership, F.C. Kohli is also recognized for grooming a whole generation of professionals who would go on to become leaders of the industry. N. Chandrasekaran, previously the chairman of Tata Consultancy Services and currently the chairman of the entire Tata Group, was a leader groomed by F.C. Kohli. He was therefore a truly leader's leader. Let's look at the great singing legend, S.P. Balasubramaniam. He again demonstrates how exceptional achievement and legendary status go hand in hand. Stature is not something that is necessarily associated with organizations and corporations. Individuals of outstanding accomplishments acquire a stature that is immense and stands out as a legacy. There is no better definition, there is no better exemplification of this than the life of S.P. Balasubramaniam. S.P. Balasubramaniam, S.P.B. or Balu as he is also called, was a legendary Indian singer who was unparalleled for his melodious and mellifluous singing. His versatility in singing and the expressiveness in his voice were unmatched. He was also an accomplished music director and a mentor for a whole generation of young singing talent through his signature program, Padta Tiyaga program on ETV. S.P.B. has to his credit nearly 45,000 songs rendered in Telugu, Tamil, Hindi, Kannada, Malayalam and multiple other Indian languages authentically, that is, keeping to the tone, timbre and expression of that particular language over an astounding 54 years singing career. There is no singer in the world who sang so many songs and whose voice remained as violent, as evocative and as energetic at the age of 74 years as it was for him at 20 years. A highly erudite person, a very humble gentleman and a charismatic expert, S.P.B. was a recipient of the prestigious awards of Padma Shri and Padma Bhushan from the Government of India. He also received several awards from state governments as well as other bodies over his illustrious multi-decade career. Though not trained in classical music, S.P.B. became a legendary singer, attained a stature of immortality in singing because of his never-ending quest for self-development and self-actualization capabilities. He would say that I treat every stage performance as a test case. That was the faith he had in the importance of training, in the importance of mastery, in the importance of craftsmanship, in the importance of expertise. That's how leaders become great leaders. Individuals, through their exceptional achievements, their exceptional self-actualization capabilities, they become legendary people. They acquire stature which is legendary for any field. Therefore, there is a need to celebrate stature. The world recognizes and celebrates stature. The awards and recognitions do span multiple domains. Some, such as Nobel Prizes and Oscars, remain the ultimate awards in their domains. India, too, has several distinguished civilian awards that recognize talent, achievement, and stature of individuals. But the leadership bandwidth in India is very huge. We are a country of 1.3 billion population. And several million professionals and several thousands, if not lakhs, of leaders with great working performance and great futuristic potential. We need to have industry organizations and associations going even more granular than they are in instituting awards that recognize and celebrate leadership, that recognize and celebrate stature, that bring stature into the mainstream of leadership recognition so that individuals are inspired to add mastery to whatever they do as leaders. The recognitions, rewards provided to such accomplished individuals is a social inspiration and a factor of national comparative advantage too. So we need to recognize, we need to celebrate stature in organizations, in our social firmament, and we need to appreciate the overriding importance of stature compared to anything else to ensure that India has got the greatest of competitive advantage and comparative advantage as we move forward globally. Thank you. We meet in the next lecture.